been one of sport's great trivia questions. The name of the last amateur to win the Australian Open. Well, for 39 years, the answer had been Bruce Devlin at Lake Karrinyup in Perth back in 1960. But a kid named Aaron Baddeley changed all that. Devlin, the affable and laconic one-time plumber's mate, took the title that year from another lily-white in Ted Ball. Devlin would turn pro and take his charm and winning ways to the US Tour for the next two decades.
Greg Turner for a birdie at the 8th, and we welcome back Jack Newton.
Yeah, thanks, Brenton. Yeah, much has changed since I left, and Battle Royal up the top of the leaderboard. Bruce Devlin, what a player he was, looking at that as we see Aaron Baddeley a little bit right from the tee.
Baddeley can't get home because he's stuck in deep rough. Now, that is a tactical error because he was only trying to lay up to give himself a pitch of about 50 or 60 metres.
So a couple of wild ones suddenly creeping into Baddeley's game. This is Turner for par at the 8th. Oh, and that's a bad miss. You could see when his ball was rolling up the marker of Pierre Fulker, so he wasn't far away, having chipped from behind the green.
And Bruce, while I was taking a break, it's as we watch Andrew Bonham play his tee shot to 10, the breeze has picked up. It's quite blustery out there now, so club selection becoming ever so important on these greens, which are firming up by the minute.
The second day, sorry, Jack, second day in a row, he's driven it past that big bunker on the left, and it's a medium iron for his second.
200 metres there, and he's just clung onto that right side.
But I tell you something, Paddy, he's going to have a very difficult putt across the shoulder, which runs across the green here at the par 5-7.
Just a few moments ago, this was Pierre Fulker. He played a great third shot. Chipped up to where you saw him putt from, and that's a par for Fulker, which will keep him at 7 under par, 3 under for the round today as we move forward to the 10th with Andrew Bonham.
This guy comes from the Sunshine Coast, Renton, and formerly assistant at Twin Waters, over to Twin Waters Resort up there, and he's a player of much promise. I don't think he's come close to reaching his potential, albeit that he's 27, 28 years of age now. This for a birdie.
See, like Aaron Baddeley, he's got his own website, abgolf.com, advertised on his cap.
Well, being up to date with all the modern technology, Renton, I'm sure you can figure out why.
People want to read all about them, find all out all they can about them. You'll need to get a website yourself, Jack. This is Greg Norman at the 8th.
Position A1 from the tee.
Jack, he had 150, and I think between 6 and 7, and I think he needed another club. He's just on the front edge.
I wonder if something put him off there.
Exciting talent with Adam Scott. Missed the green left here at 10, however, chipped up to here. So this for a par, and seemingly it's causing some problems, this short par three this week. Barred the first day, double bogeyed on the second day. This for a par, and gee, wish didn't that turn hard.
He thought he was going to miss on the left when it was about 6 inches away. But that's the test today. Windy, firm, quick. And very hard work playing golf in these conditions, mentally.
Baddeley in the bunker at 7.
Good good shot at what he's got to do here. Retton, not an easy shot. He's quite close to the lip. And a long trap shot to boot off the upslope. What a shot. Gee.
We say something sort of difficulty of it. He wanders in, one look at it, and boom.
Pierre Fourcade, the ninth, second shot down the hill at the shortish dogleg, 330 metre, par four.
Retton, I've just had a look at the ninth green coming through. He's drying out big time with some of the stress. These greens getting hard and fast. He's got to keep it under the flag here, which he's tried to do, too much so. He's right about this bunker through the green, though. Playing beautifully out here today, though.
Norman from the front, the pin at the 8th, 20 on, so this is a good one just to get close. That's the first putt he struck positively at the hole and given it a chance. Work coming back.
Oh, Nick Faldo in the early parts of the telecast have to putt from about where Robert's feet are. And no, he hasn't gone mad. He's not aiming away from the hole, but just have a look at the slope. And the speed that this putt picks up on the last third of its trip. Just got to miss that sprinkler head, and now it'll swing left and down the slope. And a bit like Nick Faldo earlier in the day, too strong, putting it through the break.
I think the difficulty there really was that probably his correct line was across the sprinkler head, and on the line he chose, he had to hit it too hard to keep his line.
Greg Norman for his par at the 8th. Well hold. Stays at 5 under par. Wayne Smith, who got to 4 under with an outward half of 33, has started back bogey-bogey. As we return to Allenby and Baddeley, the last two ball on the course at the 7th.
So it's Allenby still to play, remember? After Baddeley came out of the bunker some 30 metres short. Got it inside him.
The way he's putting, Alan Bill have to think he's got a whole list to stay within one.
And the big thing, though, he's got to concentrate on his own game and forget about what Aaron Baddeley's doing. And if at the end of the day your effort's not good enough, you shake hands and say, well done. But in the meantime, concentrate on your own game. Not an easy putt. Down the hill, left to right slider. Just move right at the hole enough to miss. One of the reasons I gave Baddeley a big chance at the start of the day is exactly what we've seen from him so far, is his putting. And I don't care who you are, if you're playing somebody and you can keep holding putts, eventually they'll crack.
Turner at the 9th for a birdie. This will swing a bit from his right.
That's
a good effort.
Turn.
He can get his par and he'll stay at 4 under. He's having a good week, Greg Turner. Currently lying in joint fourth place with Bonhomme and Laycock.
Well, a big putt here in terms of possibly the overall result. Baddeley can slip this in. He goes to a two-shot lead. And at this stage of the championship, that's a nice little cushion to have.
People saying yesterday, and I think you were perhaps one of them, Jack, that 11 under might win this championship. And with the wind getting up, if you shot 11 under for 72 holes, you'd probably
look at that again. Straight in.
Thank you very much indeed. It's no effort for Baddeley. He moves to 12 under, and he takes a two-shot lead over Allenby.
Greg Norman hitting an iron from this ninth tee. Just a short par four, 330 metres. Don't need length, you need position. Down the right, as far right as you can get it, probably to where that pin is, gives you more green to play with your second.
Pierre Fourcade from just short of the green at the ninth.
Yeah, well, it's back into the breeze, so it depends on what he feels like he wants to hit in here.
He spent a lot of time over this, Jack, over club selection, but he's gone with 5-iron. It's gusty, but the gusts are strong. He's heading to the centre of the green. And that's very good from back there. Very good from back there.
Beautiful control swing he put on that.
Windstick indicating the wind gusting there to 20 kilometres. Greg Norman's ahead at 9. Second shot. Drop it just in the front of the green, it would be ideal.
Pretty right for distance, but just tugged it left. Andrew Bonham, we saw, put his second in the right traps. So this for par. I'm sure everyone up in the Sunshine Coast will be wishing him good luck. 3 under.
3 under through 11. Just 7 players ahead of him on the leaderboard. No. Aaron Badley.
That's a shot on high of what's up in front of him. The right section of that putting surface is the 8th. The left is the 16th. It's a double green.
That's really all you're aiming for anyway. So, yep. Still straight in as well. A little off the right, maybe.
Dion, his caddy, makes a few words to him. You see that wind there gusting between 18 and 20 kilometres an hour, pretty much straight into his face. Right. Suddenly get a gust at 23, 28. That's me.
Well, that's exactly right, Jack, and that's why they're taking so long club selection at this hole, because there is such a variation in the strength of the wind from 1 second to the next.
Well, Pat, if you said that 10 kilometres an hour difference is equivalent to a club, major decision.
It's 6-iron. It's worked on it. And this very good as well. Inside. Oh, look at it now. Look at it now.
Oh, yeah. That's a great shot.
Well, we've talked about his punting. We've talked about his driving. We've talked about his approach play. What a week the defending champion is having. What is it? Talent. And let's have a look. Hand premium shot here, 6-iron and premium light shot of Aaron Badley, 6-iron.
We can see the abbreviated follow through. He punched it into the breeze. What a shot from the 19-year-old Victorian.
Greg Norman for a birdie at 9. If he can pop this one in, he'll join Pierre Fourcade at 7-under in third place. Still 5 behind Aaron Badley.
Here, Fourcade. Oh. Drops a shot at the 10th. Very short par 3, only 127 metres. Just demonstrating that a hole doesn't have to be prodigiously long to cause its share of problems.
That's a 4 then for Fourcade. He slips back to 6-under par. I said Greg Norman was going to move to 7-under. In fact, he's moved to 6-under. But they are tied in joint third place.
Yeah, Norman out in 35. Par here 72. 36 each way. So Norman gets himself into the red figures as we go back to the 8th green.
Another key shot for Greg Norman here at the 10th. Well, the wind whistles across difficult to judge the wind sometimes here. Oh, and he's found the bunker. Well, with Badly so close to the hole for his birdie here at 8, this is an important putt for Robert Allenby. He's already trailing the defending champion by 2. Missed this one, and he's likely to walk to the next tee 3 off the pace, having started the day 1 ahead of the man he's playing with. Fascinating battle between these two. So much pride at stake as well. Both desperate to win this title in their home state. Both won the title previously in New South Wales up at Royal Sydney. This then for 3. Didn't really give it a chance. Allenby makes his 4 and stays at 10 under. But Badly has a putt for another birdie. His 3rd off the day. Simple tap-in. 13 under par and 3 shots clear of the field. 10 holes to play in this year's championship.
Well, if a two-shot cushion was nice, 3's got to be better, hasn't it, Ram?
Absolutely. Yes, buddy. Playing with Greg Norman. Norman, remember, in the bunker here.
Buttage just with a for the 9-iron here, the 10. Land in the center of the green, safe, little short, but safe.
Looking at juniors, Renton, as Stephen Bowditch is. Ross Herbert, who's the head coach of the OAS, has been very sick. We'd like to send him our compliments and best wishes. Get well soon, Ross. Booker now, second shot to 11. This par four, that's number 1 ranked.
It's going to land it short and get it, try and kick, skip it up. Pretty good shot, because this green is very hard now, Jack. Good looking shot.
Anytime you get it on the dance floor at 11, under the new conditions or the old, you are more than pleased in these blustery conditions.
We've all been impressed by Badly this week. Jack, have you been pleasantly surprised at just how professionally he's handled himself this week, how competently he's played, how coolly he's performed under pressure?
Well, defending any championship's tough, but when you're 19 years of age, defending an Australian Open, that is a real tall ask. He had a fairly indifferent year in the States, but he's put it all behind him, and that's the amazing thing about this young fella. That's the shot he's got left to see the pin way over there on the left-hand side. The breeze will be coming from the left and helping.
Score service there if you want to find out just how your particular favourite has been doing. There's our wind stick giving you an indication of just how blustery the wind is. 1 minute 19. Okay, next 22, then 15, then 11.
Yeah, it's going to be Robert Allenby, I think, to play first from over on the right. A little further away from the hole, I think, than Badly. And probably a better angle to come from, although he's coming from the rough.
It is a better angle for Allenby. It will be his shot, Jack, just a couple of metres between them. The only downside, of course, is that he is coming just from that light rough, and it's one of the few pins that is cut short today, just 9 metres on. I mentioned before about his mindset. I think he... It's tough to put the double bogey aside, but I think he'd almost done that with that birdie at 3, but just at the last couple of holes, makeable putts haven't dropped for him. Of course, that, as you picked, Jack, at 7, huge putt off the slope, and he 3-putted that. So just 97 metres for Rob. Pitch it short and run it up. Here it comes. Let's see if it slings away towards that flag. It's held its line.
popping that one in to stay at 3 under. Now back to Baddeley with his pitch at the ninth.
95 metres, and it's right on line again. It hasn't run up as much as he would have liked.
Always a difficult shot to judge in here, Renton, because flat and the green really at the same level as the fairway.
Craig Norman at 11.
Well, he said he was going to take an iron off here all week, but that's out the window because here he is with the 3 medal. Breeze from the right, remember?
Oh, yeah. He's gone against his game plan here, Jack, and gone with the metal wood, trying to fly that fairway trap. And succeeded and set up a pretty simple pitch into the green at this tough 11th.
Perfect play from Norman.
Fulker up at the green at 11, putting here for a birdie. He should get his par all right, stay at 6 under. He's in third place on his own. Dropped a shot at 10, but then so did Norman coming up behind him. Hadley and Allenby.
Marvellous shot there at some of the local vegetation. Just a great example of how vegetation can be encouraged in a golf course. Now, Baddeley is just off the putting surface here. Just got to be a little bit careful because he's got a couple of metres of the fringe to come through and then onto the slicker putting surface. Big swing from left to right and it's pretty quick from there. But he's putting beautifully. And I'd suggest that's half the problem with Robert Allenby. Oh, settle. Oh, goodness.
Well,
that's careless.
We haven't seen one like that before, and it's going to be a cuddly little one coming back. Might just see 3 putts here from Aaron Baddeley. Turner at 5 under par. He's putting here for a bogey. He's been in trouble. He was through the green in two. Might even have been... So that's a... A drop shot as he slips back to 4 under, tied with four under, tied with Scott and Lakoff. And Richard Green's up there at 4 under par as well.
Now there's a big putt here, Renton. Should point out to the viewers, there's a 3-shot difference here, but Allenby with his putt for birdie. Baddeley with about a 4 meter putt coming back for his par. So big chance here for Allenby to put some pressure back on to Baddeley. If he could get this in, who knows, we might see a 2-shot swing. Rob, you were robbed.
Well, he thought it was in. Pace just gilded at the end of the day. So it's a cast iron 4 coming up for Allenby. He'll finish off, I think. And Baddeley has this for 4 to stay 3 clear. This is going to swing quite a bit from the right, Jack.
Yes, it is. That would half there of 1 over par 37 for Robert Allenby. Now Norman with his nothing more than a pitch after taking 3 medal from the tee at 11.
It's only 118, Jack, with the advantage of that drive, but he's come in short again.
Beautiful view looking down on the 9th green. Just a few minutes ago there. Aaron Baddeley rushing the ball past the hole. He's having some trouble with, flies. Or he was having trouble before he putted for the first time from just off the green. He was distracted.
Big putt, this one.
You'd get a very, very satisfying feeling if you pop this one in for 4.
that's not dead either.
And that was a careless play from Badley from the front of the green. All that was required was to get the ball down and get it four. He was not in a position to attack. Badley, who's averaged 26.7 putts this week. 71% of the fairways and 66.7% of the greens.
So he drops a shot. Badley at 12 under, 9 to play. Allenby at 10 under with the back 9 to come. And plenty of possible mistakes can be made on the back 9, especially with the wind blowing as strongly as it is now on this final day. Careful. Days. He made four at the ninth against Badley's five, so he has the honour.
Down.
Wait. It's going to run through, I would think. Down the hill. And very close to the stand, but not under it.
But that's a very difficult chip from down there. No green to play with as we go up to 11. Greg Norman. Did everything right here, but misjudged the second.
Come on.
Second shot, that is. And now he's misjudged the putt, so... that will really get up his nose because he took the wooden or the metal wood from the tee and attacked the hole, and he's come up empty.
After his boldness off the tee, disappointment. These are the holes you should watch for on this back nine. First of all, Jack, the 11th, 380 metres, and a par four.
Yeah, being stiffened up with the bunkers on the right being moved further up the fairway. This sole bunker in the middle has caused the problem. Tee tree off left. Norman took the three metal and knocked it up into this region, just leaving it pitched the breeze from the right, so that brings these bunkers into play. All in all, a very difficult par four.
The 516 metre par five, 14th, is another one to watch.
Well, it's a hole which probably presents itself as the last real birdieable hole. What you need is something up the right half of the fairway, let the contour of the fairway kick it down the left side, best angle to come from. Then you've got a choice to make. Do you lay up short of these bunkers or do you go for it? That's a decision only the players can decide, and it's a feel thing. Pin today over on that left-hand side.
A challenging par three, the 15th, 142 metres uphill, well bunkered.
Yeah, the signature hole at Kingston Heath. Look at the bunkering around here, and particularly this one left and short. Huge bunker, very deep.
And so many players have got into trouble at this hole. 391 yards, par 4, 16th, Jack.
Well, invariably, this is the hardest hole on the course at Kingston Heath. Blind tee shot, you can't see where you're going. Tee tree right and left. The ideal place to be is down here, just on the right, short of the bunkers, which gives you the best angle to spear your second shot in. Bunkers right and short, and the pin today at 16, 22 on and 15 from the left.
The 16th today, the second most difficult hole. The most difficult hole today is the 11th. But we're looking down, first of all, at the 10th, with Allenby through the green, and as Jack says, with a very difficult pitch from just below the stands. And a lot of people have been walking about there.
Come straight over here, mate.
People walking out behind and under the stands too, Renton. That's the problem at the moment.
Stand still, thanks.
As I said, just a little bit of out of sorts at the moment, Robert. Not a lot of green to work with here.
Well,
it still. 2 metres for par.
Greg Norman, as we said, attacked the hole from the tee, short with his second, putted to here. This to save par. This really will leave it. This doctor shot. Well, that really will. Take it across.
I don't think Greg Norman's going to win his sixth Holden Australian Open this week as we go back to the 10th.
Aaron Bradley's played a great shot in here. Keep it on the green and give himself an uphill putt. He couldn't really, apart from walk up and put it closer to the hole, he couldn't give himself a better shot at a two from this side that he's coming from, because all the slope from the hole back towards where he is, so he's putting uphill, a little bit of right to left about it. This to stretch his lead back to three.
Well, that's run on a bit too, but at least he knows the next one is left to right.
Well, he's done it all week. He's made sure everything he's putted has got at least to the hole and beyond, and he's wrapped them in coming back. There's nothing like the final 9 holes of an Australian Open to test your nerve out.
Left-hander Richard Green here at the 12th for a birdie, which would move him to 5 under par. Richard Green having a good week here. Finished strongly in Europe. With a good finish in the Italian Open at Imolas in Sardinia. Bringing that game here with him to Kingston Heath. Stays 4 under. Well, 2 little testers, Jack, for par.
Absolutely. First of all, Allenby. Getting a little niggly with himself, as Pat said. Couple over for the round, and he needs some of that positive attitude that he provided on the back nine yesterday. So it's back to Bradley now to stretch his lead to 3 once again. Suddenly, the pursuers are running out of holes.
Do you bang this one in, Jack, or do you put it on the left lip and just tickle it towards the hole?
I'd be tickling it down there and trying to dive in the hole, but that's not the way this man putts.
Bang. Yeah. 3 shots clear again, 12 under par, Bradley. Allenby at 9 under, 8 to play. Yeah, short cut the 12th.
The line is there, plus a club link.
So something just distracting him, and quite rightly, if he's not ready.
Well, the son of a famous Swedish swimming champion has just hit a lovely sand on here, but it has to get up. It's going to be short.
Third shot of Pierre Fulker, because it's a pretty long hole into the wind today.
It's going to have to go, Renton. It's not going to be enough into the breeze here. Definitely short.
Trying to bounce it into the green. And, well, he can still make his 5, can still make his par, but he would have loved to have made a birdie here. You never know what might happen. He's 6 under. He's lying 3rd at the present moment, behind 3 behind Allenby, 6 behind Bradley. Laycock, Green, Greg Norman and Greg Turner all on 4 under par on this sunny afternoon at the Heath. Welcome back. Aaron Bradley leads by 3 and he's on the tee at 11.
But he's got the driver, Rhett, so I guess it just shows you that he's got got no nerve, this fellow. He's just taken the driver out. Smashed it way up the fairway. Beautiful shot.
Some people may be worried about that bunker in the middle of the fairway. He certainly wasn't. Scott Laycock up the 14th. The par 5. This is his third shot. Remember, he's currently at 4 under. Oh, good shot. Good chance of a birdie to move to 5 under and take fourth place on his own.
Robert Allenby, he's going with an iron.
Here's the more conservative approach, Jack. No need to pull the driver out yet. This one's safe too. It's going to pull up just short of the fairway trap.
Well, he's 3 behind. One might have thought he might have attacked the hole, but this is a hole that has been changed at Kingston Heath. Jack, talk to us about the changes at the 11th from the last time we were here.
Yeah, well, I think the first thing to recognise is that the big tree, the second big tree, is gone. And the bunkers have been moved further up the fairway. This one here on the middle of the fairway has been instigated. But the tee tree is still on the left. And it was always a decision from the tee whether under the current regime or the old hole, that's the bunker in the middle of the fairway. You had a decision to make from the tee whether you attacked it or not. Because if you take the driver and you don't hit a slider, as we say in the trade, that's a left to right shape shot. You run out of fairway into the tee tree and pushes off to the left here, or right as we're looking at the screen from the high camera.
Jack, are you surprised that Allenby took an iron there?
I am, but Renton, you've got to remember that for some golfers, a slider is a fairly simple shot to play. Robert Allenby is a drawer of the ball, shapes it from right to left, so it's probably his least favourite shot to play. And it really depends on how you feel on the tee.
Well, as he assesses what he's going to do, he's got a much longer second shot, of course. Peter McWinnie finished with a 76 today for 6 over par. Martin Doyle a 72 for 2 over. Kenny Bruce a 72. He finished 1 over par for the championship. Shane Tate 73, 2 over par. Walker came up short with his third at the par 5, 12th. Pretty good at these little shots. He's going to make his par, and he's going to stay 6 under.
Big putt for Scott Laycock. This would move him into outright fourth by himself. This for birdie. This to take him to 5 under. Well done. He's been on song right from the first hole where he held that nice putt for birdie. 3 under for the round. Terrific goal from Scott Laycock.
Here's the difference on these two shots. 182 left for Robert. Long, long way down the breeze. I'm standing right beside his dad. Now this is going to pull up, and there's no way in the world you can pull it up if you land that far up the green, down the breeze from that distance. In comparison, Badley only has 89 metres left.
Pat, you're absolutely right. There's no way you can stop that ball pitching it anywhere near the middle of the green. You have to land it short from way back where he was. And 2 holes in a row, we've seen him knock it over the back. Remember at the par 3, he was long and left. And again, hit long here at 11.
Fulker at 12. Popping that one in for par, staying at 6 under. And in third place, battling at the present moment with Laycock for third spot. Laycock 5 under. And of course, a much shorter iron, Pat Welsh, for Aaron Badley.
Yeah, a drive of right on the 300 metre mark. Just 89 metres left. This one short. Now watch this one run up. It's quicker than he'd like, but a realistic birdie putt, whereas Robert's going to make a very tough up and down.
Commercially very sound, though, with a 3-shot lead, I would have thought.
Looking good at the present moment for an Aaron Badley. Successful defense, but much can happen before the end of this final round of the Holden Australian Open at Kingston Heath. Rob Robert Allenby, who won this title in 1994 under a bit of pressure. Here at the 11th, he's three shots behind Aaron Baddeley, the defending champion, and now he is concerned. We welcome back Bruce Critchley. Problems for Robert Allenby.
Yes, he recovered so well from that six at the first one, thought that it was going to be a boost, but things have just got away from him in the last hour or so.
Yeah, well, one would have thought that it might have been Baddeley who tightened up a bit, but it seems to be that Allenby is the one who's suffering the most under the heat.
Scott Laycock at the short 15th, beautiful little hole. Tee down below, and you play up to a green that is very well bunkered.
Safely on the dance floor, no harm done there. Outside chance at a two. Well, I think this is just about the ball game here. If he doesn't make this, I can't see him catching Baddeley. This for a bogey. Remember, he's had two chips from over the back. So he's going to drop at least one shot. Two shots surely will be too much to make up. Five shots. Strange things have happened, of course.
It would have been there for five. Instead, it's a double bogey six hanging over the hole, and it's not going to drop.
Yes, I mean, if he's going to, if he were to catch Aaron Baddeley, he needs a lot of help from the young man, because you can't pick up birdies.
Well, remember that
on this sort of course.
Baddeley's going to be putting for his three. This is Fulker at six under par through 12, second shot to 13.
It's been a good hole to him this week. Brendan, he's had a couple of threes here so far, and they will get a third. Beautiful shot, pin right at the back. 30 yards, 30 metres on from the front.
Jack. Oh, it hit the hole as it went past. That one didn't go in.
I like the speed he hit that one. I thought Renton had only gone, well, half a metre past at the most.
This to go to the next tee with a five-shot advantage. He's just got to keep himself in the present and not think about what's happening.
He showed last year how wonderful he can do that. He did it admirably last year when people were close to him, the likes of Norman and Colin Montgomery were hunting him home, and he never flickered a moment during that.
Five shots in it now with seven holes to play in this year's Holden Australian Open at the Heath. Pierre Fulker now just one shot behind Robert Allenby, Scott Laycock and Greg Norman on five under, but they're seven behind the leader.
Dollars left. Here's Allenby, 12th tee, and he'll be full of venom. Big bunker in the middle. You choose left or right, and he's chosen right and almost beyond. These are some huge drives. 530 metres this hole, so nudging 600 yards for the older lags. Not in range for anybody.
Fulker missing his birdie attempt. Successful with his par, as we now look at some of the highlights courtesy of ANZ.
This update brought to you by ANZ.
And here is Pierre Fulker playing his second to the fourth as he challenges for a top three position on this final day. Setting up a birdie opportunity and taking advantage of it on four. Robert Allenby made a nightmare start at the first, but here's his second to the third, and this really does steady him down. Birdie opportunity and a chance to get one back. One of two that he dropped at the first. He does get it. Greg Turner has been in contention all week. Here he is at the fifth, picking up a shot. But the man they've got to catch, and at the moment they can't, is Aaron Baddeley, his second to the fourth. He's got all the answers. Plays a gem. And his putting has just been outstanding.
This update brought to you by ANZ.
And here is Aaron Baddeley. Right now playing his second to the 12th.
Well, he's flirting with this right-hand side again. There's a big clump of tea trees down here on the right, but no, he's going to skid by that. He's okay. There's no problems over there.
Robert Allen.
Yes, Bruce, plenty of steam on these two. He smacked that drive, didn't he? He didn't bother going left or right of the trap. He just went straight over the top, and that's 256 to carry it into the breeze, and a great three were there, but boy, things have slipped away in the last few.
Now, Fulker, tee shot at 14. Birdieable par five if you can hit two good straight long hits.
This one's okay, Jack. Got a lot of draw on it and running into the left-hand side of the fairway. Right, be right, okay. Right. Had to lay up from there, though.
Greg Norman is currently at five under, one behind Pierre Fulke. Norman.
Oh, Norman from a dreadful light, 13 from a pull drive, and very difficult to get a decent contact out of there and way short.
So a battle for
a bit to the right and try and use the contour to work this back to the stick. Notice the open stance, down the shaft, short shot. Short swing required. Lovely shot from Greg Norman.
Let's return to the 12th. Aaron Baddeley leading by five.
And looking oh so confident, Sandy's. Real winner's gait about him. This shot just from 100 metres on this monster par five out to the right-hand side of the flag. I'm not sure we can get a check on it. Impressive, Jack, isn't it?
Richard Green's been having a good week as well. This third shot at the 14th. Currently four under. One under for the day. Oh, that's a lovely shot there. Both he and Lonna in with a chance of a four. Birdies, remember, the last of the three par fives.
Pat was talking about winners' gates, the body language telling a different story for Robert Allenby.
Two big hits, though, Sandy, to get there back into that southerly breeze. He's only some 14 or 15 metres short of the green, so he's taken a gamble here, and like we said earlier about Greg Norman on 11, having taken the gamble, now he needs to convert. Wants a good pitch here. Not an easy one because he's pitching across the shoulder of the green. Quite a bit of dead ground between his ball and the putting surface, and coming just from the light rough. Good shot from where he was.
So hard, those shots. We'll go ahead to the 13th, and this for a four for Norman. And right from the start, there's been absolutely no joy, no heat, no excitement with the putter. And it's now holes since he actually had a par. Three bogeys in that stretch.
Richard Green, chance to go five under. Didn't see a lot of him on the first 2 days, but a 68 yesterday has certainly brought him back into contention. He remains at four under par, holding down a share of fifth place behind this man.
Well, it really has been wonderful, and certainly it would now seem to be a lot easier task than the one he had last year, and that didn't sort him out. For those of you who enjoy statistics and numbers, he's a couple under today. He just needs one more birdie and no drop shots to have four rounds under 70.
To emulate his performance last year.
This might be it. This might be it. It's straight.
A walk with destiny. Catch me now, he says to the rest of the field as Aaron Baddeley is staring at his second straight national title.
Well, he can enjoy himself now, surely. Have some fun.
Six ahead and six to play. That's a huge.
It's certainly worth another look at a Hahn Premium light shot.
Yeah, two for the price of one.
Beautifully red, wasn't it?
Mm.
As opposed to Greg Norman, the shot we had before, an inside right lip putt and starts left of the hole. And then
he chats with his caddy, Dion Kipping, while Allenby probably the hole after that got a fraction smaller for him.
Very hard because there's been a roar from the crowd and it's not for you.
Okay.
Here, Fulker, third shot at the par five. He's tiptoed down this hole, as is his wont, and got into a nice position. Good short game, very sound all round player. But playing golf in Europe this summer, he won't have found many courses with greens this firm and fast. It's been a very wet time in the whole of on that tour.
A bit of heat on this one, I can tell you. For obvious reasons, and this one, I think it's going to be, yes, it's past Aaron by about 5 to 10 metres, I'd say. We've got a 290-metre drive.
Not that far short of the putting surface, in fact.
As he heads down 13, let's have a look at this hole. It is really a good birdie opportunity, Jack.
Well, particularly with the breeze behind the players, so you've got the choice of laying up from the tee, or as both Baddeley and Allenby have done, smash the ball past all the bunkers, all the trouble, up into sort of this region here, leaving themselves with not much more than 40, 50 metres to the front of the green. The pin today, as we've already seen, cut 30 metres on and 7 from the right, so as far left as you can get, the better off you are, because the shoulder of the bunker eats into the second shot. 3.87 averaging, so it's averaged under its par, but I repeat, largely brought about because the breeze at the players' backs.
Richard Green now on the par 3, 15th, 142 metres. The car in the background up for grabs. It's already been won once by Larry Austin. Richard Green couldn't do much more.
Brilliant shot. Hit the flag stick, and quite often with these fiberglass flag sticks, the ball will just run straight down the stick and go in. But there's the problem that I was just talking about with Aaron Baddeley's shot. It's down breeze right to left, and really to get this close, he's got to take it over the middle of the second lip of the bunkers. But if you're going to be smart, you just play the commercial shot, given that you've got a commanding lead. Beautifully played.
Commanding lead. Back. bag full of confidence and a great deal of skill. Here's Fulker at the 14th for a four. This is to go to seven under. Join Allenby in second place. He's got the legs, not quite the line.
Just for the viewers at home, Bruce, that may be wondering why we're not seeing too many birdies. This is an Australian Open on a difficult golf course. Fair bit of wind, firm, fast greens. And it is not easy to get a birdie out here at the moment.
Robert Allenby will certainly attest to that.
For it to be marked because it was right on his line, and he would have hit it by the look of that.
Hit to 14. Greg Norman. Gonna have a crack?
So I think he will. He's 263. He's got the driver out, and he needs to do something pretty startling, doesn't he, to say the least?
Yeah, he was asking if it was clear to go.
So he's been waiting, Sandy, for him to hit, waiting for him to get off the green, and now he's ready, so 263, it's a decent ask into this wind. He's been a bit wayward today, Greg, you know, up and down, round, bogey, birdie, bogey, birdie. He really needs to come home with a couple of birdies. Here we go. Great contact. Now heading left, beach.
In fact, just landing, Jeff, between the two bunkers, short and to the left.
Not a bad miss, though.
No, it's all right. In fact, he's played really very well, sensibly. He's played within himself. I think maybe you just say a little ring rustiness as Badley goes for his three at the 13th and may just be the shortest putt he's missed this week.
Dare I say it, doesn't really matter. I think you'd even back yourself to defend a six-shot lead with three to play, wouldn't you, Bruce?
Yeah. Let's move to 18. And Brett Ogle, three over for the championship, playing his second to the last.
Put away to a bad start. Sandy dropped the shots at the first three holes. Three putted the first green and never really recovered from that, Brett.
Down where many have gone before him.
Green should be a two, and it is one of his best performances since that fine win against Norman and Roosner in the sands of Dubai.
Now Robert Allenby with a chance to peg one back. Now it gets back to eight under, and five shots the difference. Five to play.
15. Pierre Fulker, a couple under for the day, and at the moment in outright third place.
Yeah, pretty good looking shot here, bringing in right to left. It hits the heart of the green, it releases and goes back to the green. This will be a very, very quick putt he's left with here.
The three dimensional angles, but that gives you more of an idea. As these huge crowds gather around 18, marvellous amphitheatre finish, and they'll all be waiting for the leaders to come home.
We talk about the finish, Sandy. 11's ranked two today, 15 fives, 16 one, 17 seven, and 18 10. So it's five shots to diff, but there's some tough holes to come.
That's right.
Robert got home here yesterday. He's smashed another great drive down here, but a lot of ground to catch up now, isn't there, with only five holes to play.
There's Nova Paris Kneebone. Great to see her out. And her daughter, Jessie, on the right, watching Robert Allenby and Aaron Badley.
And she too is a very keen golfer.
Yes, she is, Sandy. Yeah, she likes a golf. You can imagine if you could wield a hockey stick, you should be able to wield a golf club, although they usually swing too flat, hockey players.
Badly.
Down the left side. Ooh, into the crowd. Jumping away, we'll have to see how far this has gone in.
Well, I think it came to a fairly abrupt halt, actually, Patrick. Well, the one thing, it is a par five, this, and provided he's got some sort of lie, he can lob it up over the brow of the hill and be in nice range and not bother him, but that was just a little quick, that one.
Yeah, he doesn't quite finish his backswing.
Norman on 14, third shot. Just that little bit ring rusty to mount the full challenge this week, but it's been there or thereabouts.
Aaron Baddeley's on the verge of joining a very elite group, a group that includes Ivor Witten, Ozzie Pickworth, Gary Player, Jack Nicklaus, Norman Von Neider, and Greg Norman.
Four over. Fred Ogle, final round, 77.
Yeah, not a good day. Perry Price, 78, Brett Ogle, 77. Oh, oh dear.
He'd done the difficult bit, hadn't he?
Had a heart attack. It looked like it was going in and just stopped stone dead.
Back. But he had the difficulty. He got the line right. So a couple of shots he's dropped in the last six holes. A hit to 16. First of three par fours to finish here at the Heath. This is Richard Green.
Hang on. Oh. That's a good shot now, but very nearly disappeared down the swale to the right.
Up the hill. But also very hard when the one thing you want, which is the title, is now beyond your grasp. To keep it all going and finish well, you have to hit your shot and take on that bunker on the left-hand side if you want to get close. As the wind's helping him from the left.
89.
Caddy Dion is telling him he's got 89 to the front.
Just 85 metres for Aaron. And this one coming up just a touch short. Oh, it's got a lucky kick off the face of the trap and it's kicked onto the green. I don't think we're going to make it otherwise.
To 15. Greg Norman on the sand can. When you consider, Sandy, that camera's in the face of the bunker and you're still looking down at him, it gives you a very good idea of how deep that bunker is. Certainly can't see over the lip from down there. And Baddeley, I suppose, at 14, really quite lucky that didn't roll back down into the gully alongside Allenby. Well, obviously essential, Jack, that Allenby gets this very close and starts to try and turn some sort of pressure. I suppose the one thing he hasn't done today at all is ever really put any pressure on the young man.
Well, I think it was the other way around after the debacle at the first. And, of course, as I said right at the start of the show with Sandy, I gave Baddeley still a big chance to win, although most people would have felt that Allenby's experience would see him through. The one thing that I felt was in Baddeley's favour was he was putting better than anybody else. And as you know, if you can continually knock putts in, I don't care who you're playing against, it will upset you if you aren't getting your share in. And probably Allenby feels that way today, that everything's gone against him.
He's had a wonderful air about him, Badley, as he strides along. It's a walk in the park in so many different ways. But vital now for Allenby to get this right up alongside the hole. So I'm going to get another shot off you.
Pretty good putt for speed. Just overcooked the line a little bit. Pretty much looking like he'll make a birdie though and pull another one back from Badley, and good shot from on high at 15, the par three. Look at that bunker, it's magnificent.
Norman for par. After coming out of the trap, sees another shot disappear. He's back to two under. We move ahead to 16. And Richard Green, an opportunity to go to six under.
Four though on what's been the hardest hole on the course. Perhaps disappointed he didn't convert after a brave second shot.
What's absolutely essential for Aaron Badley here is he doesn't do anything silly like three putt. Well, that he's certainly not going to do so. Young as he is, he'll be well aware that Allenby isn't going to birdie each one of the last six holes. If he keeps doing his job correctly, making pars, maybe picking up a birdie at one office, but inevitably his nearest opponent will run out of holes.
Shots are not out of the realms of possibility though, Bruce, over the last four holes at Kingston Heath, particularly if Badley goes at the stick at the next. I really think that he's got to play conservatively over the next couple of holes, maybe rushing off there for a nervous twinkle.
Comfort station.
Comfort station, is that what you call them?
Well, in America, I think that's the phrase. But yes, I think he's just got to make his pars and by the others. Fulker, fine drive down 16.
He's going with six iron. And here he's left out to the right a little bit, and it's going to get in that bunker. Not a good shot.
It's been a terrific round. He started the day after rounds of 71, 69, and 74. Couldn't get a birdie to save his life yesterday. Start of the day two under, so he's three under for the round. So a good championship for Scott Laycock, who plays most of his golf these days in Asia and Japan. Final hole.
Job they're putting them down there, Jack. There's a lot of divot holes if they weren't.
Yeah, well, it was interesting. Parry chipped from there, and everyone else just putted. Parry, obviously, one of the best chippers in the game.
Tough pin, isn't it? 23 paces on. We go back to 15.
Really can't afford to go out this stick. I mean, Allenby's got to try and bring this over the right edge of that big deep bunker. And if he can, just try and work it a little bit from right to left. Not easy to do when you've got a lofted club, such a lofted club, although it is the natural shape for Robert. He does move the ball right to left.
That's right, Jack. It does suit his shape on 27, but really, he probably has to go out It's not far away if it gets the right kick now. It sat down a little quicker than he would have liked, but pretty good shot and uphill putt for birdie.
That's an excellent result, I would have thought. That's exactly what Aaron Baddeley needs to look at here. Shot from on high. That's the bunkering all down the right. Slightly uphill, as you can see.
Yeah.
Players can't see their balls land on the green. But he really doesn't want to... See, notice he closes his eyes there. He's trying to imagine the shot before he plays it.
Last shot at the Holden too, Jay. It's already been claimed once this week. This one coming up maybe just a touch short. Oh, it's just stuck over that bunker by about a metre or two. And it's a safe play again.
Aaron picked up his first check just a couple of weeks ago. Some $16,000 US. First prize today is $225,000 Australian. He hasn't got it yet, but he's certainly got his hand out. Under, Falker is now playing his fourth shot. Remember, had problems coming out of the trap. His ball was plugged.
He's entitled to feel a little aggrieved because these are not bunkers where the ball does plug by and large. Here's Scott Laycock at the final hole to finish with a five, to finish four under par.
Round of 70 for Scott Laycock.
Well done. Oh.
Well, he will be steaming, so watch out.
Three shots gone in two holes.
Back to the action at the Heath. Greg Norman, second shot to 16. Two under par, the same score as Adam Scott.
At 6-iron for Greg into 16, into this fairly decent breeze. Looks pretty good from here if the weight's right. Good lucky bounce. That's a good shot.
Absolute carbon copy of Richard Green. Second in, and he's got the putt. We know it's quite a left to right break. But we'll go back to the tee over the brow of the hill.
Great shot from on high at why this hole is so difficult. You can see the tee sit down below the fairway level, so it's uphill, a blind tee shot. You can't see where the ball finishes. Tee trees right and left, and we can see there from our wind gauge into the players' faces from the right. Ideally, you want to be down the right-hand side. The bunkers are at around about 260 from the tee. It's a pretty intimidating tee shot, and that's why I think we see players come unstuck here, not just with the tee shot, but the second in here also pretty tough.
250 of these traps down the right. Usually starts it down the right side. It's going to come up short of the traps and in position A.
Wayne Smith shot a 72 today to finish one under. Peter O'Malley a 73, also one under. And Nick Ahern a 73, one under. Scott Laycock, we've just seen finish at plus four. At minus four, Brett Ogle at plus four.
First time Badger's hit Ahern off his tees to go with the wood. Four ahead and three to play. Plenty long enough to get up with this. So he's probably
maybe it's not all over yet. Terrific tee shot from Allenby, but you can see he's hitting downhill to the green. Very difficult shot to judge in here. I always reckon that even when you were reasonably confident about the right club, it was never an easy shot to judge in here.
I was thinking back those 6 years to when Allenby won at Royal Sydney. I mean, there are no more difficult circumstances than the sandbelt courses, the breeze up, this was at Sydney, but these sandy courses, they're playing like links, all the pressure of the championship upon you, the wind in your face. It's very, very hard to play, and you can be made to look quite silly.
And Bruce, I can tell you, he's only got 148, but choking down the 6-iron, I can tell you also that Badly has a poached egg in the bunker, and this one's headed to the heart of the green. Good shot. Now we could see a swing here.
Terrific shot from Robert Allenby.
Heard Pat saying there that his opponent's got a poached egg in the bunker, and we saw what happened to Fulker with that. Very hard to get down in three.
Well, he's got to go across the other bunker, Bruce. That's the problem. He may have to go left of the flag, just try and get the ball on the putting surface.
Pierre Fulker playing his second of 17. He's at 3 under par. Those greens really have changed in colour, haven't they, in the last 12 hours?
That one certainly has a burnt look about it.
It's amazing. Richard Green having a good finish, Bruce.
He is. He's finishing best of all. He's 3 under for this 9. He's just birded that 17th hole. He's in third place all on his own now. A couple of shots of, so a 4 here or maybe even a 5, and he's got third place money.
Here's the ball, Aaron Badly. Well, what's the secret to playing a shot like this when you're that far, Jack, still from the pin?
He's got to try and bring the club down steeply the back of the ball and aim left of the flag, as I suggested. Well, actually, he's played a pretty good shot. Smart shot. If he'd have gone at the flag, the potential to leave it in the other bunker was very real. But just no way you can get any spin on that shot, and it's a very hard, fast green, particularly that left third of the green. The ball's going to get away from you.
Virtually what Pierre Fulker did as well. In fact, speaking of him, here he is. Playing now his third to 17.
On it trundles. But so quickly that you can lose your confidence and the rhythm of playing and the balance of playing these courses when you start to drop a shot or two. Fulker really struggling to maintain a good finish at a great championship, but he can sense himself chucking large quantities of money away.
Well, I think with the firmness and the speed of the greens, if you don't keep your wits about you, they can really make you look foolish, some of these greens, and it unnerves you, and then you just can't seem to see a way in.
True.
And I'd suggest that that's one of the reasons that four players at the top of the leaderboard, excluding Greg Norman, of course, I'm not quite sure how we come to get he being a Victorian, but certainly the predominance of the Victorian players at the top of the leaderboard.
That's a phone.
Well, this is a very, very crucial moment. If he can keep the damage to one shot, he'll be quite happy, but two, just the numbers unnerve you.
The click of a camera as he played that. It's unfair. Not allowed.
I'll tell you one. It's a very difficult putt he's left himself too.
So let's just get this in perspective. Badley currently at 13 under. He's putting for a bogey 5. He's asking his playing partner, Robert Allenby, if he can take that ball out of play. Probably been damaged where he was plugged in the bunker. So Allenby on in 2 shots, putting for a birdie to go 10 under. Aaron Badley putting for a bogey. If he misses, a double bogey will take him back to 11 under. So a couple of huge putts coming up here, ladies and gentlemen. Robert's got an unbelievable record in match play situations and also playoffs. But he's got some pegging back to do before any of that'll happen. This for birdie.
Back check his 2 wins in the US this year have been via a playoff. And that was so close.
I think he knows he had to make that.
Yeah.
But he might still cut the deficit in half. Badley doesn't hold that, and Badley will be rattled. There's no doubt about that if he does take 6.
And if it did get to a playoff, you might favour Allenby because he's never been beaten in 1. 6 out of 6. It's a long way away yet, though.
Well, he's been brushing these sort of putts in with tremendous regularity, and particularly when he's needed them these 4 days. He needs this one.
Well, suddenly, the mood has changed and the complexion has changed. There's a murmur in the crowd.
They're all beginning to wind their way towards 17 and get a vantage point because they sense the tingle of anticipation.
Yeah, it's a classic case where you just can't get in front of yourself on a great course like this in an Australian Open. I think Badley a couple of holes ago may have had his winning speech written out.
Yes. Who could blame him? Perhaps when he led by 6. It's a different story now. He leads by 2. This is Pierre Fulca.
The way things have been going for him.
No, he's had a rough old finish, but he is there. First prize, $225,000. Second prize, $127,500. Third prize, just over $84,000. Fourth prize, $60,000. And fifth prize, $50,000. 2 holes to play, 2 shots the margin between first and second. Robert Allenby, 2 strokes behind on 17.
This one right up the middle. Be perfect, and that's long.
Go on.
Those traps, 282 out, and he's not far shy of them.
Head to 18. Richard Green.
This is a birdie to take him 7 under. Oh. I think he's probably going to wrap third place up because that's 6 under finish. Good weekend for Richard Green, 68-69.
Now Aaron Badley on 17. Bit of a change in the mood here, Patrick.
Yes, Andy, there is. When he looked at that poached egg before, as he hits a perfect drive up here at 17, he should have had a smile and said, well,
I suppose I was due for a little bad luck, but the demeanour has changed quickly after the double.
OK, let's have a look at 17. The middle one of three finishing par fours, Jack.
Yeah, it's a feature of this hole, of course, is the blind second. Tee shot needs to be positioned up the right half of the fairway. Quite an incline from the tee, and then you hit over the top of the hill. You can only see the very top of the flag, and then quite a downslope to the front of the green. So you've really got to try and pitch your ball just on or just short of the front of the green and let it scamper on up to the stick, which today is cut 21 metres on and 8 from the left-hand side. So all in all, a pretty tough hole to get a birdie on, and as we can see, and Robert Allenby desperately needs one if he's going to challenge badly up the last. Only 8 birdies, averaging 4.12. And I think it's averaged about the 7th most difficult hole all week.
I think one of the really difficult parts of this course is the green itself. There it is, and you can see it's getting brown and stressed and firm and hard, and it's got some funny contours on it. And I think the reason it's played as hard as it has all week is to do with the shape and the constitution of the green. It's very hard to, if you pitch short, you stop, and if you pitch on the front edge, you rear through.
160 metres left for Aaron. He's come all the way up the fairway over the hill to just reconfirm in his mind where that pin is. And as Jack mentioned, it's all the way back today, 21 metres back. So the ideal shot to pitch it as close to the putting surface as possible. As you mentioned, Bruce, you get it on the putting surface, down the breeze. It's so hard to stop it. Two shots was his winning margin last year.
Come on.
Now this one heading towards the front edge. Oh, I tell you what, this could be perfect now. Watch it feed down. Oh, that's a great shot from back there. Great shot, 8-iron.
Some anxiety there, shades of Sergio Garcia.
Yes. The problem was he didn't have a tree at the base of the ball. It wasn't the base of a tree. Yeah.
Under the circumstances, fabulous golf shot. Here we go, there he goes. He was to see it land because they all know that it's such a fickle green, this. And back down the fairway, Robert Allenby knows from the crowd's reaction that he's in there close.
I've moved further up the fairway, Bruce, but I'm anticipating from 150 that Robert will hit 9-iron and jump on it, try and get it near that front edge and take a similar bounce to Aaron's. Because as we said, any more than a couple of metres onto this green and there is no way in the world he'll hold it. Breeze at their backs.
Interested spectators there. Stephen Bowditch, who's one under par, needs a 4 at the last, I think, to equal Andrew Buckle in the amateur. As we watch Robert Allenby play his second.
Well, this has got plenty on it, Jack. It's right up near the flag. Oh, it's pitched into that little bank. You couldn't have pitched anywhere else and stopped it that quickly.
Not all that bad, though. He's got an uphill putt from the back of the green because the last third of the green here gets right away from you. And so he'll be putting uphill, in fact, for birdie.
Let's just pop over to 18 and Andrew Bonham, who's putting for bogey because he lost his ball. And that is what caused the holdup. It's been some considerable time before it was declared lost. Well, Sandy, that is a really expensive finish. Going from level to plus two, a 74 has become a 76. And a few £1,000 spent there. Playing with him, Adam Scott.
Well, gee, Adam Scott's had a roller coaster ride. He really had it going the front nine out 34, and then he started back. Bogey, birdie, bogey, bogey, birdie, bogey. So he's had a real up and down back nine.
This to finish one under.
Yeah.
Good solid strike of the ball. And we'll see a lot more of this young man in the years to come. Robert Allenby making his way to 17 and just surveying the situation.
Although Robert Allenby's off the back of the green, I surmise it may even be Aaron Baddeley's putt first, as he's further away. Looks like it will be Baddeley's putt first.
And he'll be, all he'll be trying to do is get it close, make a four. Obviously be nice to hold it, but and keep the pressure, because when you come up the last, Jack, two shots is so much more than just one.
Oh, absolutely. You could easily take five at the last if you're particularly trying to defend, but two shots. I think Aaron Baddeley will just hit an iron from the tee anyway.
Well, we've seen the last couple of days almost go too far with this driver. And rather like at 16, the one way you can really chuck it away is take the big club and wallop it in the trees.
Anyway, knowing this young man, he's thinking about holding this.
Correct, Jack.
We're all thinking about all the possibilities.
He didn't hear a word.
I'm shutting the door on this event.
And that is just what he has done.
Well, when you consider 16, too. Do that.
Look at this again. And premium light replay. Just shows nerves of steel. And he's sending out a message there.
It was motoring too when it went in. I think it would have been a good meter, a meter and a half past the hole.
Dion Kipping is caddy there with him, taking a couple of deep breaths. So he's all but shut the gate.
Must putt for Robert Allenby. Stay within two.
No.
Hold it, everyone.
Four plates. Four plates.
Hold it.
Now, guys, one to finish.
Well, I said it was uphill. It was, but once it got to the hole, of course, looks like it was fairly race past the cup. Mind you, the surface looks like it's pretty bare, pretty quick.
Yes, the greeny brown linoleum. I thought, funny enough, when he did it, he hadn't actually hit it hard enough. He really did. No way of stopping that.
It's going to be a tough one for him to hold now, because everyone will be rushing to positions for round 18T, and he will be putting towards the 18th tee.
Understandable, because even had he held it, it'd have been three behind. Well, that was probably too much. Of all the scenarios, that was not, would have been the hardest to predict.
To 18. Greg Turner. This for par, and this for an even par round, and to be square for the championship. Turner, who figured strongly in the first 3 days,
especially after that opening round of 68. 70, 74, 77.
Here's Fulker to finish with a three and get some of the shots back. So a costly final four holes for the Swede. So he's had a great, been a feature in this championship.
Round of 73 for Pierre. He finishes at 3 under. So scoring has not been easy today, with just three players back in the clubhouse breaking 70. And they were all out this morning. Chris Gray, Andrew Buckle, and Stuart Appleby.
Wonderful battle unfolding amateur ranks between Stephen Bowditch and Andrew Buckle. This is Bowditch playing the second shot to 18.
Wonderful follow in the air. Just caught the top of the bunker. Well, an exciting finish. It's been a memorable day for young Bowditch. There with Greg Norman.
The green looking back down the fairway to where the great man Greg Norman is, about to play second.
Well, Jack Cripps going in with 9-iron into 18. Disappointing day, of course, for him today, of a final round, but still hasn't stopped him drawing the crowds. Just have a look at these people around this last hole. Right in the center of the fairway and flag generous in the back of the green. Let's see if you can finish with a birdie. See if you can turn it on for the crowd. He loves the crowd watching. He's been doing it for years. Well, it's looking pretty good. Right at it from down here. Oh, good shot.
Pin high, Jeff. You're right, he's provided many various finishes over the years. This ball just sliding down to the right. But he has given us so much drama and so many highlights over the years.
Well, it's been a bit of a hold up here because, as we said, Andrew Bonham lost his ball. Hardly what you'd want as a 19-year-old trying to win back-to-back Australian Opens, waiting around. But he is so composed, this young man. And Bruce, he's got the driver out, which kind of surprises me a bit.
But it's now a four-shot lead instead of the two.
Unless he's thinking it's 265 to carry the bunkers.
That's what I
wonder if he
say.
Thinks he can carry them. It'll take right them out of play.
That's exactly what's in his mind, and he's done it both days. There's a little bit of room on the right, but as you say, it's when you have to hang around, it's very easy for extraneous thoughts to creep into the mind. Anyway, here we go. He leads by four.
The driver well down the fairway with a very nervous family, and that's found. There's a little, yes, the puff of dust was the giveaway, wasn't it? He's in the trap.
We could see it roll back to where now he's going to be lucky to get a backswing. He's quite near the tongue, which sticks out. Well, not as close to it as I thought.
Top of his flight, that ball. No real harm there.
That one's skipped out of the trap and has it stayed on that tongue between the traps.
Aaron's parents, Ron
His father leading the way. His family heading down to the 18th green to greet their son. And one can only wonder how they must be feeling at the moment to seeing him win as an 18-year-old amateur last year.
Now, yeah. Stephen Bowditch needs a good chip here to try and tie his mate, Andrew Buckle. As the leading amateur comes down the slope. Very good shot from where he was. Buckle, of course, beat him in the World Junior Championship in San Diego.
Two young men we're going to see a lot more of, though, Jack.
Absolutely. Both very good players.
Richard Green is back in the clubhouse, and he has got third place all locked up. Aaron Baddeley is not far away from winning his second straight national title. Just four players left out on the course. One is Stephen Bowditch, this 17-year-old amateur, and what a way to finish. What a way to finish. 72-70. 70-75 for this young man.
Greg Morley to match him. That's a four for him as well. It was an up and down round. He had four birdies, but he had six bogeys as well.
We'll next see him in the Greg Norman Holden International. He'll be played at the Lakes in Sydney starting on February the 8th next year.
Robert's ball looks like it did exactly what Pat said. We couldn't quite see it, but it's jumped out of the lip of the bunker right into this tongue in between this part of the bunker and the next. And it looks like it's very thick. There you can see what we're talking about. And it looks like it's sitting right down in amongst that heavy rough. Can he get it to the green?
Sitting very poorly, Jack. The only chance it can run, there's no chance of getting any spin out of there. It looks like it's going to do just that. Go, 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 go. Just short. Good effort from there. Bad luck.
He's got a couple of shots in hand of Richard Green, who's at six under. But it was a day that he would have really looked forward to, leading by one going into it. And from the very first hole, the script went wrong. Well, from back in the bunker, you can probably just about get there. The lie didn't look too good the first time we saw it. It looked to be in one of the little rakes of the bunker. With a handful of shots in hand. Not the time for heroics.
Bruce, he's got plenty of space from the lip. He's way back in the trap, as you say, as long as he's got a fairly decent lie. I'm down the fairway, I can't even see his head. But he's got a 9-iron in, with a good, plenty of room from that lip. Now he's duffed it, way left in the people here, Nelly. Way short.
The first thing he had to do was make sure he got it out, which he did. Not an easy one because he had the ball below his feet, blind, steep bank in front of him.
Good angle, isn't it?
But he's not happy with it. Wasn't how he saw the shot, and whether it's an Australian Open or not.
Come on, Aaron. You never like to drop a shot at the end, but all credit to him, he's on his way to...
He's polishing his shoes before the presentation. I think that's lovely.
Good.
Well, he's certainly going to save you this moment once again. So his father, Ron, how proud he must be.
Well, there's only, you talk of all the people who won Australian Opens back-to-back, only one man has ever won it as an amateur and then as a professional, Carnegie Clark.
Way back. Some time ago.
Getting on for 100 years ago.
It's an amazing effort. It's a great story in Australian golf. I remember you interviewing me, Bruce, last year before the Australian Open at Royal Sydney, and Garcia was on everyone's mind, and I reminded you in that interview that we had a fella here that I thought was as good as Garcia. Watching him win this tournament, I've not seen anything to change my mind.
Well, he's technically so good.
Naturally,
he has a little. Dale Lynch looks after his golf swing, but it's all very much what he grew up with. It's only just a fine tweak. And beautiful balance. He's looked so good all week.
Great thing I think about all this is that as heavily involved as I am in junior golf, this is great for our kids to see a young fella who's a good stamp of a young bloke, carries himself well, manages himself well, and is successful. And I think that's good for the game.
And what he's doing as he enjoys this very special moment is bringing young people to the course. The young people are flocking here in their thousands to see a fellow youngster taking on the big boys and in some cases beating them. Yes, Mum. Joanne and Ron, his sisters Kate and Emma. What a moment.
One of a few shillings, the other one was Grandma.
There you have the traditions of open championships around the world, the crowd allowed onto the fairway in front of the green, the perfect amphitheatre. It's a wonderful story, isn't it? His grandmother encouraged him to take up the sport. Didn't just take it up, grabbed it with both hands.
Well, I think the important issue there is that neither of his parents play, and it's generally perceived that that's how you're introduced to golf, but there's a lot of exceptions to that rule.
Sure, she'll be feeling very proud at the moment, his grandmother Jean. But, it'll be Robert Allenby now with his third shot.
Look at this massive putt that swings from left to right. Goes up the ridge there and then down over the other side and starts bending back to the right. Very good putt from where he was.
I have to think he might continue and finish out.
Yes, he may do. Particularly the way Aaron Baddeley putts, it might be the last stroke if he gets him a shot. And
that would be in his mind.
All hell will break loose and Robert's still got to putt out.
Yes. Fortunately, he could afford to take two from here and still come second on his own.
Just to explain that, there's a bit of an unwritten law. It's not cast in stone, of course, but you allow the winner to putt out last for obvious reasons.
A brave attempt by Robert Allenby after a record 64 yesterday. 75 for Robert today.
Yeah, I felt that apart from his six at the first, 10 and 11 really let him down today, where he started the back nine, 4-6, bogey, double bogey. This is a most enviable position to be in, Bruce. I think even you and I could get this home now.
Playing foursomes. It
is. Under Baddeley, next best Allenby, his playing partner at 8 under. So, but there's a lot of pride at stake, and having been in this position, not this far in front of the Australian Open, but other tournaments, there's still some pride there, and he'll want to make this and finish the tournament off the right way and not take a bogey on the 72nd hole. Not that it matters. You don't write how, you write how many.
Least of all, do you wish to
3 putt. Final arena. But it must say it has been his putting that has been the... Well, there have been many great parts to his game, but his putting has been a joy to watch. His ball dispatched each time with the abandon of youth, the confidence of youth.
Well, I think what he epitomises, Bruce, on the greens is that he's not afraid of them. And I've always felt to putt well in Melbourne, you have to be confident that if you miss one and it runs 2 or 3 metres past, you'll get the one coming back. And all the good putters down here, the Bob Shearers and the Stuart Gents. Done that, but not a blemish until the final hole.
That aside, it's over, and Aaron Baddeley is the Holland Australian Open champion for the second successive year, this time, though, as a professional. An outstanding achievement as he rewrites the record books. As Bruce said, only one other person, Carnegie Clark, has achieved the feat. A relieved family embracing their brother and the son and the grandson. Should mention was an even par round of 72, and he finishes 10 under.
Team Baddeley seemed most pleased with that.
Every right to be. Great future awaits. A nice handshake there from his Eisenhower Cup. Steve Bowditch shouldn't have been in the Eisenhower Cup, but recently they were amateurs together.
From Joanne and Ron, happy, relieved, and proud parents of our national champion, Aaron Baddeley.
A wonderful performance by Aaron Baddeley, only the second man to successfully defend the title, having been an amateur when he won it the first time and a professional on the second occasion. And you've got to admire the young man for his performance this afternoon.
Oh, I thought it was fantastic, Rhett, and I suppose most people would have felt that Allenby, with a great year that he had and the experience that he's got, probably would see Aaron Baddeley off, but it was actually the other way around, and probably Baddeley's attitude and his putting was just awesome all week. Really saw things turn the other way, and in the end it was Allenby who couldn't handle it.
Jack, you mentioned Team Baddeley. Well, Pat's down there with the head of the team, if you like, Ron Baddeley, and his wife Joanna.
Ron Baddeley, you just had to confirm with Joanne that it was 2 shots.
Yes,
it was
I did.
A few heart pumping moments up the last, but certainly another victory.
Oh, it's sensational, Pat. To go back to back and still a teenager, it's just sensational.
Pride? It's a fair word, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Pride. It's just wonderful. A dream come true to go from being an amateur, winning it, and then going to be your first professional and winning it as a game.
Hasn't been the easiest of years, has it? I mean, the spotlight was so much focused on him after that victory at Royal Sydney.
Yeah, I think it was always going to be that way too. You know, once you've won the Open and being a young kid, I think Australia was looking for the next, you know, up-and-coming golfer, and winning the Australian Open last year certainly, you know, made it pretty hard for him, but it's been a good year of education for him over there.
Not bad after just 2 events is in excess of $250,000 in the bank.
Yeah.
You never think of that at this stage, though. You just look for the silverware.
All right.
That's true.
Well done. I know you've helped him all the way through, and all the congratulations to you and the family.
Yeah, thank you very much, Pat.
Thank you.
Aaron Baddeley, the winners, a very, very happy appearance. And rejoin us in just a moment for the presentation ceremony here at Kingston Heath. A stirring sight indeed, the pipe band coming up for the presentation ceremony here at Kingston Heath after Aaron Baddeley successfully defended the Holden Australian Open Championship. A pipe band, but playing an Australian tune, Jack.
I thought you might have known the tune, Renton, because that'd be familiar territory for you, the kilts and the
and the pipe band. Well, it just gives a touch of class. Remember, the game was started in Scotland, and the Australian Championship is one of the oldest championships in golf, a championship that's been won in the past by such luminaries in the game as Gary Player and Norman Van Nijder, and Jack Nicklaus came down here, and now Aaron Baddeley.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you'll keep your applause going and give him a standing ovation, because today he has, and this week, he has rewritten the record books. The Holden Australian Open champion for the year 2000, Aaron Baddeley. There he comes, our champion as an amateur in 1999 and as a professional in the year 2000. As he makes his way up, I'll ask Ross McKenzie, the Executive Director of Sales and Marketing for Holden, who've been fantastic sponsors for a number of years now, to come forward and say a few words. Ross, let's make him welcome. Ross McKenzie, ladies and gentlemen. Holden, Australia's number one car company, is proud to again sponsor Australia's number one golfing event. The Holden Australian Open has attracted a first-class field, and on behalf of Holden, I congratulate all players. Holden's leadership is evident in our ongoing commitment to golf. Our first-class Holden signage, top prize money, and the Holden Hole-in-One prize, collected on Thursday by Larry Austin, a brand new Holden Commodore SS. Well, it's been a great battle, but in the end, there was a clear winner. And unlike last year, when he walked away with only Holden's congratulations as an amateur, I'm delighted to be able to present Holden's check for $225,000 to the winner of the 2000 Holden Australian Open, Aaron Baddeley. Thank you. And let's hear from him now before we hear from Bruce Lee. And Aaron, if you'd like to come forward, I'm sure everyone around Australia, in fact those watching around the world, will say congratulations on a mighty effort. Was the putt at 17, was that the sealer? Take us through it.
Yeah, I think that was, I had a great read there, and hit a great 8-iron in there, and I just trusted and let it go, and it went in.
Got the driver out on 18, were you a little pumped then? What did you say to your caddy?
Let's just hit it down the middle of the fairway, because that's what we've done all week, and let's just stick with the game plan.
You don't appear to have any nerves. We watch you on the putting green, and really it was your putting that held it all together for you this week. It was just fantastic. But you're a young man in a hurry. You have a look at it, size it up in probably 2 seconds, and go bang. Next minute, you're taking it out of the cup.
Yeah, well, the brain knows where to hit it. You just got to look once. The brain goes, all right, there's the hole. Let's put it in.
Got a crackerjack brain. Look, I know you want to thank some people, so please, the microphone is yours.
Thanks, Andy. First of all, it's a great honour to be able to successfully defend the Australian Open title. There are a few thank yous. First of all, I'd like to thank my Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, once again. He's been with me the whole year, and I just want to thank him for sticking by me all the time, and he was definitely here for the week. To my family, Mum, Dad, Emma and Kate, thanks for your support through this year and every other year I've been playing golf, and your support is just unbelievable, and I know I wouldn't be here without your help. To my coach Dale, you've been awesome. Unfortunately, you couldn't be here on the weekend. He's helped me out so much this year and years previous, and I know I wouldn't be here without him. To Dion, my caddy, you're a great mate, and what a great caddy. Just keep me hitting it straight and keep my nerves under wraps, and thanks for everything. To Vern, my strength and conditioning coach, thanks for your dedication this week. You've been here every morning, every afternoon, stretching me, making sure I'm right for the next day, and that's very much appreciated. And to all the people that have stuck by me for the year, thanks so much. I know it's been a tough year, but it's great that you've stuck by me and looked after me. To Holden, AGU, and all the organisers, once again, it's a very successful Holden Australian Open, and you've done a great job, and hope it keeps getting better every year. To Kingston Heath Golf Club, the golf course is in magnificent shape for the week. Greens were great, and just the whole course was awesome, and thanks for that. And to all the fans who came out and helped support me this week, and all my friends who are over there waiting at the party, thanks so much for all your help and support, and great that you've come out and helped support me. Thank you. And to Robert Allenby, yeah. We had a great day today, and I much appreciate your sportsmanship. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Aaron Baddeley, our champion for the year 2000. Receiving the trophy from Bruce Nairn. Let's hear it once again for Aaron Baddeley, ladies and gentlemen.
A wonderful moment there for Aaron Baddeley, and it really was Tim Baddeley, wasn't it?
It sure was, but boy, they could be proud of him. He's some player, and we're going to be seeing him on the golf courses all around the world for the years to come.
A very impressive performance. I hope you've enjoyed our coverage of the Holden Australian Championship. Until we meet next time, goodbye.